Greetings, everyone. As you can probably tell by this British accent, this is not Raymond Yin. He's taking a well-earned break, so today you have me, Mark Patrick, technical lead for Mouser Electronics in EMEA, and once again your host for the Tech Between Us podcast, where today we'll be taking a deep dive into the fascinating world beyond Industry 4. Let's face it, the pandemic really shook up our supply chains. You could say we're still recovering, highlighting the need for more resilient and adaptive systems. Not only that, it also caused us to take a moment and focus on the ever-growing need to be better stewards of our planet and its resources. Enter Industry 5, where technologies like AI and IoT are poised to transform how we manufacture and distribute goods. But what does this translation mean for businesses, workers, and society as a whole? With me today is industry expert Leonardo Dentone, Programme Chair of the International Society of Automation, or ISA, Denmark. Join our conversation as we explore the philosophy, technological advances, and industry implications behind this human-centric evolution. Leonardo, welcome to the Tech Between Us.
Hello, Mark. I'm very excited to be here, and hello to everybody around the world who's listening to us.
Very good. We're really pleased we could have this discussion today. Let's start with a little bit of background information and tell us a little bit about the International Society of Automation, or ISA, your role there, and then a little bit about the work it does to support the adoption of industrial automation technology.
Yes, so the International Society of Automation is a non-profit organization founded in 1945 under the name of Instrument Society of America. And then it decided to expand the scope to automation when automation started becoming a thing. Its purpose is education, training, networking, and setting standards for a wide range of instrumentation and automation technology in the industrial world. Many of its standards constitute the global reference in their field, especially ISA 62443, which is very well-known in the cybersecurity world, and then ISA 88 and 95 in batch control and manufacturing operations management, respectively. As a program chair of the Danish section, so ISA is organized around local sections in different countries. I have responsibility in Denmark for preparing the content of the events, and I work in close collaboration with the board of ISA to prepare meaningful comment at our contents at our events in Denmark. It's important for me to state that I talk on my behalf, not on behalf of ISA, just for housekeeping. And then I earn my living as a senior consultant in a Danish consulting organization called Implement Consulting Group. It's a powerhouse of 1,800 people. And I'm part of a practice that deals with operational excellence. And specifically, I'm part of a working group that drives helping manufacturing companies in achieving digitalization across the whole spectrum. So starting from strategy, going into technology design, vendor selection, and implementation. So across the whole chain with a very hands-on approach.
I think we're going to come on to talk about many of the aspects you've mentioned there. For some of our listeners, perhaps they're not completely familiar with the industrial automation world. So perhaps you can give us a sense of, you know, the brief history of industrial automation, and perhaps people, you know, forget really that's come from a long time ago. But how have we, you know, what is that? What does that backstory look like, and how have we arrived at Industry 5.0?
Absolutely. So we talk about five industrial revolutions, if we may call them this way. First industrial revolution was about the introduction of steam engine and mass production. The second one was about the introduction of electrification and advancements in steel and chemical industry mainly. And then we really talk about industrial automation starting from the third industrial revolution. So with the advent of computers and more advanced digital technologies and electronics, they started taking over on shop floors around the world. And then when we look into Industry 4, I like to explain what it is about using a maturity model developed by Aachen University in Germany, which defines Industry 4 as a journey outlined in four steps. The total steps are 6. The first 2 are referred to in the industry 3, and the latter 4 are referred to industry 4. So if we talk about step number 1, it all starts with computerization. So bringing digital technology and electronics on shop floor. So being able to sense and manipulate the production processes through sensors, actuators, and the digital logic that was that didn't need human intervention in order for to act on a production process. Then we proceed into the second level, which is connectivity, being able to control the machines from a central point, or not necessarily from distributed computers across the shop floor. And these 2 steps are sequential, as one may understand, and they are part of Industry 3. If we look into Industry 4, the first step on the maturity journey is bringing visibility into what's happening on the shop floor. So starting connecting all the assets to screens and making the data available on the shop floor, not necessarily acting upon it, because there is not necessarily a shared understanding of what this data means. And the fourth maturity level, that is about transparency. So starting finally to understand what the data is telling us and act upon it. The fifth level is predictability, so being able to not just react upon information that is happening in real time, but being able to understand what is going to happen in the future. So predict behaviors and of machines, of processes, and of people utilizing data and advanced technologies, and then being prepared towards what is happening. So being able to adapt before events are happening. And the last level is about self-optimization. So we heard about lights out factories and all those engineers dreaming about a world where we don't need humans on the shop floors, because all machines are just working autonomously. So they are able to react independently on the basis of the data that they collect, and the whole production processes are orchestrated in a self-optimizing way. Now, one may ask, what comes after this? Doesn't sound like there is a lot more, and yet we still have to talk about Industry 5. So Industry 5 was born out of a European Union initiative. European Union is a supranational union of countries that is economical, political, but it's a lot about aligning all these countries, member countries across Europe, on a series of values. And in policymakers, they have listed these sustainable development goals that they are really much around being the triple bottom line. So people, profit, and planet. So being able not to focus only on profit, but also on providing a positive change to the world. And if you think about what happened during COVID, then the link between this, what I just said, so alignment towards positive values and what happened during COVID, explains the 3 pillars of Industry 5, which is nothing but a change in the approach to which we look at the Industrial Revolution. So the 3 pillars are sustainability, resilience, and human centricity. If we think about COVID, the word resilience, we all have heard this so many times, and it's about being able to react to disruptions, but we can list countless different examples that affected supply chains in the last years. We talk about human centricity, that is stemming from an increased focus in workers' well-being that COVID really put in the spotlight, because people are not willing to come back to work with the same conditions that before COVID, right? And sustainability is just in line with the policymakers' efforts to make our future greener and make sure that we are more aware and sensitive to our planet's resources. So in terms of technology, there is not really a step change, maybe just in terms of an increased focus on artificial intelligence, because that's news that came, especially with generative AI, that came after COVID. At least it started taking over after COVID. But it's really a change in approach. So sometimes I call it Industry 4.1 due to this reason, not a step change in technology, but just in the approach. But then policymakers are much better at marketing than I am, and they understand the need of branding it under name Industry 5 instead of Industry 4.1 to stress the importance about this change in the approach and make sure people get it, really.
Yeah, yeah, that's an interesting point. You know, going back to what you were saying earlier, the enabling technology, I see the same picture, really. It's largely the same with an increased availability and accessibility to AI tools now, which will, I guess, further enhance the capabilities. And the human centricity side of it, I know we'll come on to talk more about this, but that utopian dream of a completely robotic production process, lights out, as you were saying, I think is something out of a science fiction movie, perhaps, rather than reality, because, of course, we still need to have meaningful work and meaningful jobs for people, which could be one of the benefits of Industry 5 as we see people moving into perhaps higher value roles. Which kind of leads me to my next question, really, because having sort of set the scene there of what industrial automation is, how we've arrived at where we are, what 5.0 really means, what do you see as the benefits to both people and processes by adopting this human-centric approach? Sustainability and resilience, I think, are very easy to, certainly at a high level, explain. But when you get into human centricity, then, of course, you know, we start to think differently. So what do you see as the benefits there?
Engineers, and I speak, and I'm allowed to say this because I speak as one, are not as emotionally intelligent as other people generally. So we need someone to remind us that employees are people before they are numbers, before they are FTEs. So
I'm more than a number.
Yeah. And as we have explained a minute ago, anything that comes before lights out factories and the level 6 of the maturity index in the Aachen University's Industry 4 model, anything involves people, is manual to a certain extent. And this increased focus on better working condition is very crucial for especially retention, engagement, and attraction. When I talk with the business leaders in the industry, I've heard multiple times that the nature of work after COVID has changed. Now it's harder to get people to show up on time, to show up even. It's much harder to retain them and especially attract people from the younger generations because they are less and less willing to work in these noisy, dirty, repetitive jobs.
A set of different expectations, I think, came out of that situation. And I think even in our world, which is distribution, you end up coming up with a hybrid model that satisfies the needs that became apparent, certainly after COVID.
Absolutely. And one of the key drivers behind this human-centric approach is that workforce in first world countries is shrinking. By 2040, we will see 1.3 million less FTEs in Germany. See, I just called employees people as FTEs to prove my point earlier. 7 million in Japan decrease and 81 million in China. So workforce is shrinking and it's becoming more fluid. Last year, I was working for a very large corporation within the food and beverage industry producing packaging, and they had facilities in Phoenix, Arizona, in a large industrial park. And what we have seen in that situation was that this factory had a huge turnover in employee turnover above 50% per year. So this factory had a massive problem around attracting people, keeping them in their factory, and then training continuously new people, just simply because a new factory was popping up next to it and they were able to offer a slightly better working condition or slightly higher salary, and then people were just shifting. So this is one of the reasons why human centricity will become more and more important. And it's good that we have highlighted stress on it because it tends to be overlooked in this continuous strive for optimization and more efficient processes.
Yeah, which I guess is what you're describing is the former sort of asset-centric approach, which is that's all that mattered really. Whereas, of course, without people's involvement and the creativity and flexibility and adaptability that people bring into a situation, that couldn't continue. So you come up with a shift, I guess, from asset-centric to human-centric. Is that a fair description of what you experienced in Phoenix?
Yes, absolutely. And it's the industrial world has been historically characterized by high capital investments. So naturally, there is a high focus on assets and how to get the best out of the invested capital, obviously. But what we see today is that there are technologies that are increasingly human-centric. And one of the clear examples, and that's proven by the fact that it sees one of the highest market growth in industrial software, is this new family of connected worker applications. They are nothing but some light applications that can run on tablet or phone, and they are more similar to what employees are used to use in their personal lives on their smartphones. And they are all about providing a lighter way to engage with each other, to engage with machinery, to capture knowledge and to share it between each other. So they become a powerful tool, and they are an example of human-centric application, as opposed to, for example, manufacturing execution system, especially the large ones that we that historically have dominated the market, where the focus was really machines and assets, and less about providing a user-friendly interface to people and so on and so forth.
Which are the things that we naturally experience in our everyday lives, as you said, in personal lives. So that makes it so much easier and so much more intuitive for people to work in what could potentially be a highly complex technology-based landscape. So getting that interface right, I think, is critical to having the human centricity as you've described.
Absolutely.
If this conversation has sparked your interest in Industry 5, you can explore more from Mouser's Empowering Innovation Together content series by visiting mouser.com/empowering-innovation.